Happy International Women's Day and welcome to Innovate UK's and KTN's Women Innovate event. I'm Siobhan Smith, Diversity and Inclusion Knowledge Transfer Manager at KTN, and I'll be your compere throughout the day, keeping an eye on all your questions and comments. Please make sure you are logged into our attendee platform where you can find your schedule for the day and the sessions you are registered under My Schedule. Click on the session directly to find out more details about them, and you can watch the main stage live stream at any point during the day. You can explore the attendee list and book one-to-one appointments with other women in the community by heading to the appointments tab, or discover more about our speakers and partners. Post your thoughts or photos onto the event feed or get involved in the conversation on Twitter by using the hashtag WomenInnovate, which will be pulled into the social wall. If you have any questions, please contact our event manager Poonam or watch the short info video to help you navigate the platform. Throughout the platform, you will also receive notifications about exclusive deals for the Women in Innovation community throughout the day, so don't forget to keep an eye out. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce your host for this session, Emily Knott, Head of Equality, Diversity and Inclusion at Innovate UK. Emily leads on Innovate UK's work to promote diversity and inclusion in business innovation and has been instrumental to the success of the Women in Innovation programme since it was established back in 2016. So over to you, Emily.
Very much, Siobhan, and hello everybody, and a huge welcome to everybody here today to our Women in Innovation event. So today is International Women's Day, and what better day for us to all get together and celebrate the achievements of women in innovation working right across the UK. But not only that, to think about the role, the really important role of our partners here today, networks, organisations and individuals who are providing the essential support that those women need to be successful. It's also Commonwealth Day, and the theme for Commonwealth Day this year is women's leadership and in developing a common future. And on a personal note, there's another reason for me why today is very special and worth celebrating. So if you're in England, the schools are back open today for all students. So my two boys were very excited this morning at getting back to primary school. So yeah, huge celebrations all around. I think what I'd like to say, though, right now is that it is just a day, and our work on women in innovation, the work we do to promote this agenda, is not about one day. It's about every day, and it's, you know, all the time we're thinking about this and working and driving this agenda forwards. So as Siobhan said, I lead on equality, diversity and inclusion programmes at Innovate UK, and Women in Innovation is one of the main programmes that I've initiated since I've been doing that role. And what I'd like to do is spend a little bit of time providing you with some information about the programme, a bit of an update on where we are, just really to set the scene for the event here today. So the programme kicked off in 2016. And before we launched the programme, we carried out a number of activities. So the first thing we did was we looked at our data. We looked at our applicant data, who was applying to Innovate UK. And at that time, we found that only 1 in 7, so that's 14% of lead applicants for our funding, were women. And obviously, we weren't very happy about that statistic. We also looked at success rates, and we found that there wasn't a statistically significant difference between men and women who were applying for our support. So really, we wanted to focus on driving up the number of applications from women. At that time, we also did a little bit of research, and we carried out some interviews with women to try and understand and build our understanding of what are the challenges that women innovators face, and what are the opportunities, and what's the role that Innovate UK could play in developing a programme to help address that. So key findings from that research were things like the biggest barrier for innovation was access to funding and finance, and that is felt more acutely by women than men who are innovating. We also heard lots about the importance of mentors and the importance of being part of the right networks. We heard that there's this persistent lack of relatable role models for women innovators. And we also heard that there was a lack of visibility and awareness of what support is available for innovators and also the role of Innovate UK. So at that time, we didn't have the Rose Review, it hadn't kicked off, but there was already quite a lot of research and evidence talking about the huge untapped economic potential by getting more women starting businesses, more women doing entrepreneurship and innovation activity. For example, there was a report by Deloitte at the time that looked at women's participation in early stage entrepreneurial activity. And that report stated, if we could increase the participation levels of women to the same levels as men, then we could unlock £180 billion for the UK economy. So we kind of took all of that on board in terms of designing the Women in Innovation programme and campaign, and really tried to address all of that. And at its heart, really what we're trying to do with the programme is to increase the number of women innovating in the UK. We want to increase visibility of the women who are innovating. We want to create new role models to inspire more women to get involved. And we want to provide access to the right support at the right time for that community so that they can be as successful as possible. So what is the programme? Well, one of the key parts of what we do is our awards, and we have had three waves of support for our awards programme so far. The wave one was all about testing the water, really. I mean, we hadn't done anything like this before, so we were trying to see, can we reach and engage with more women who aren't already talking to Innovate UK? Can we find more women out there with amazing ideas for innovation in the UK and start to work with them? And it was a huge success in that wave one. We had a huge number of applications at the time and very high quality applications. Wave two was about the grand challenges in the industrial strategy. And again, we were absolutely blown away with the response, and we found lots and lots of women-led businesses working on solutions to those big challenge areas. And then wave three, the focus there has all been about regional diversity. So what we're really wanting to do is demonstrate that there are women right across the UK who are working in innovation, and we want to share their stories to show that breadth across the UK. And you'll be hearing an exciting update on wave three shortly. So with our award winners, we've done a number of different things. We've had a photography exhibition with Getty Images, and that's all been about shattering stereotypes for innovation. And what does an innovator look like? What sort of journey have they been on? What do they do? And we've also worked with award winners where we have unveiled some purple plaques at schools across the UK that have a connection with our award winners. And this is about inspiring students at those schools, having this connection with innovation and getting those students to think differently about career opportunities for them and what being an innovator might look like for them in the future. So that's a really important aspect of the work that we're doing. The group of award winners is an inspirational group. They're doing amazing things. As a result of the awards, you know, following on from that, they have built their businesses, they've grown their businesses, they've gone on to secure lots and lots of additional investment, and they go on to gain recognition in lots and lots of different ways for the work that they're doing. But the other thing that's really important to flag about the group is that the businesses, the innovations that they're working on, are so strongly driven by passion and purpose. And I think you'll get a feel for that when you meet with some of our award winners at the event today and hear about the work that they're doing. So the awards are a really important aspect of the programme, but they're not the only thing that we do. So we're working now with thousands of women within the community that we've built up since 2016. And we need to do more than just find women and signpost opportunities. What we're really trying to do is ensure that the women that we're working with are in a really strong position to access those opportunities and to benefit from them. So a lot of what we do is providing practical advice to that community, helping to build new connections and do a lot of peer networking. And that's all really, really vitally important. So we're really pleased with what has been achieved so far. We've seen a 70% increase in terms of the number of women applying to Innovate UK for our support. And there's more to be done. So I don't know, some of you may have seen the report by the Enterprise Research Centre that was released last month, and that looked at the challenges involved in getting more diversity in R&D and innovation. And it talked about those challenges as being wicked problems. And I think we should see them as wicked opportunities as well. And that there is still a lot more for us to do. There's more that we should do, that we can do, and that we will be doing in the future. There are gaps that I want to fill and new areas that I want to be focusing on, working with everybody at the event here today. So I'd just like to finish off by sharing a couple of quotes from some of our award winners that I think really nicely describe why we're doing what we're doing with Women in Innovation. So firstly, Carmen Hijosa, who is the founder of Ananas Anam UK, and her company produces a product called Penatex, which is a sustainable alternative to leather and other materials using the fibres from pineapple leaves. She says, the world needs more empathy, transparency, and total commitment to the ecological and social challenges facing us within the next decades. The role of women at every level in society is absolutely key to tackle and solve these challenges. And then Daniela Paredes-Fuente, who is the co-founder of Gravity Sketch. Now, Gravity Sketch have a product which is an immersive collaborative design platform used by Ford, Nissan, and Reebok, and 50,000 creatives across the world. She says, when I heard about the award, I immediately wanted to apply, not only because I would get support as a women entrepreneur, but because these kinds of initiatives push the needle and bring more women to the table. And if there's anything I can do to help with that, I will do it. So that's kind of sums up really nicely what the program is all about and some of the thoughts of our award winners. That's all I wanted to say really to set the scene for today. And I am absolutely thrilled now to be able to hand over to Amanda Soloway, Minister for Science, Research and Innovation at BEIS. And she's here today to officially open the event and also provide us with some exciting updates. So Amanda, over to you.
Wow, well, thank you. Thank you so much. Lovely to be here. And I really am genuinely honoured to be opening today's event. And it's so important on International Women's Day that we celebrate. You know, we must be celebrating and celebrating the incredible talent and success that we all benefit from when women really push those boundaries and innovate. And everyone on this call will have done their part to make women more visible from breaking new ground in their own fields or working towards more inclusive practices in your organisation. And I sincerely want to thank you for this. It's just so important we acknowledge that this is a real radical change that we're making. And we should be screaming from the rooftops to inspire change for the next generation of inventors and disruptors. And we know the potential, you know, boosting the number of female entrepreneurs could deliver £180 billion to the economy. We can only imagine how ideas and solutions, but from women's own lived experience, will be so valuable in building a better future. Equality, diversity and inclusion, you know, of people and ideas is absolutely integral to excellence in research and innovation and letting the UK access the best talent and benefit from the broadest range of ideas. And as champions of women in innovation, Innovate UK have played an amazing role in putting an end to the cycle of low visibility and absent inspiration to celebrate the women leading the way in innovation today. And so as part of this, I am genuinely thrilled to announce this year's winners of the Women in Innovation Awards. From Belfast to Bristol, Cardiff to Cambridge, the female innovators looking to make the world a better place in 2021 and beyond come from across the UK. Winners include technology to help young people manage better manage their money, to eco-friendly period products, and an online community platform that tackles the issues of product shortages during the COVID-19. And I'm struck by how many of the winners have been proactive and inspiring during the pandemic, choosing to challenge the disruption and working instead to solve some of the most pressing societal, economic and environmental challenges. The support the women, the winners will receive will help the development and delivery of these incredible ideas and the people behind them. Most important, perhaps most importantly, they'll also bring a tangible difference to people's lives. And the winners come from such a wide range of backgrounds, professional fields and ages, proving there's a wealth of female talent in the UK ready and waiting for networking, funding and support to create truly outstanding innovations and products. And I'm particularly thrilled to see such a diverse spread of winners. Just like me, Innovate UK believes that ideas come from everyone. And so we'll be working together to inspire more innovators from underrepresented groups and promote participation and innovation from a diverse range of people across the UK. It's been nearly 5 years since the award was announced, and we've already supported over 60 women and stimulated a new community of female innovators from over 6,000 men with over 6,000 members. And since then, the number of women leading application for grants for Innovate UK has increased by 70%. The recent Hampton Alexander review published just last month shows that we're starting to see an increase in women in senior roles. And it's programmes like Women in Innovation that are really helping to provide pathways to success for women, paving the way for greater gender parity and greater success for British businesses. And as we have all seen, women across the UK are rising to the challenge of the pandemic. And so what can we as government do behind them and what we can do to be behind them all the way? So as UK Science Minister, I'm privileged to be able to meet with prominent female researchers and innovators who are expert in their fields, whether in R&D, space industry or engineering. And I passionately believe that space is for that science is for everyone. And this goes right through developing the pipeline of delivering transformative new technologies to markets and to customers as well. And that means creating an R&D environment where people from all backgrounds and experiences can flourish, an environment where young girls and women are encouraged and supported to pursue diverse and interesting careers that push the boundaries of scientific knowledge. And we're committed to ensuring brilliant women can come to the UK from around the world and have developed the new graduate visa and global talent visa, which adds increased flexibility and opportunity to the routes to help support talented individuals from around the globe to study, live and start careers here. The new Office for Talent are working to ensure the UK's talent offer is stronger than ever for students and those building their careers and those who are already world leaders in their field. Researcher mobility and knowledge exchange are absolutely vital for a healthy R&D. And I hope that the UK Association to Horizon Europe will support further cooperation and mobility between our researchers. To pave the way forward to achieving our vision for global collaborative future for science, we've published the Research and Development Roadmap in July 2020. And the roadmap was the start of a discussion which led to developing an R&D people and culture strategy. And this will set out the direction the R&D sector needs to take to ensure the UK has the people we need at all levels, working in a culture that brings out the best in everyone and delivers the best outcomes for the country. When we look to the future, it's undeniable that science and innovation will be crucial in helping to boost the economy, create jobs and just build back better from the effects of COVID. And it's undeniable that women are critical to this. And I have to say just briefly about myself, if I may, you know, I haven't had a traditional career path. I came to politics very late, always had an ambition to be in politics, but just didn't believe in myself, just didn't really know how to get there, how to follow or so soon. So that's why I've actually came to politics when I was in my 50s. And I want to encourage people, whatever their ambition, to really follow their dreams. And we need to be making sure that we are enabling that. And so thank you for all the work that Innovate UK is doing. And so to the winners, well done. And to everybody on this call, I hope you will enjoy the fascinating forward-looking roundtables and panels for the rest of the day. Busting myths about women in innovation sounds like a great session, and I really genuinely wish I could take part in myself. But it's not just the winners we should be celebrating today. It's also a celebration of bringing together our aspiring female entrepreneurs through network events like today. And I know many of you perhaps wouldn't be here, wouldn't be where you were today if it wasn't for the support, connections, knowledge and encouragement Innovate UK provides. And so thank you sincerely, Innovate UK. Our previous winners are already doing incredible things. I know this year's winners will continue on that journey, paving the way for female innovators of the future. And so back to you, but honestly and genuinely, my sincere thanks. Yay, let's celebrate. Fantastic work.
Wow, thank you so much. And it's just brilliant to have you here with such strong support, and also, you know, hearing some of your personal reflections on all of this and your story, Amanda. And it's great to get updates on the government-led initiatives that are really promoting the wider equality, diversity and inclusion agenda too. So yes, thank you for being a champion for women in innovation, and thank you for being here and kicking this event off today. We do want that radical change you talked about, and we should be screaming from the rooftops right now, and that is what today is all about too. So thank you, and I'm now going to hand over to Paul Mason. So Paul is Director of Innovation Policy at Innovate UK, and for any organisation to make progress, real progress on equality, diversity and inclusion, you need to have support right from the top of the organisation to make it work. And I am very pleased to say that Innovate UK, we absolutely have that strong support from the top. Paul is kind of an example of that, and he'll be telling you about the importance of equality, diversity and inclusion to the work that we do at Innovate UK now, and actually our future plans and the strategy going forward. So over to you, Paul.
Thank you, Emily. Is my mic working? Can everybody hear all right? Great, good. Okay, let me crack on. So Amanda, just let me thank you again, echo Emily's comments for those, thanks for those positive and inspiring remarks. I couldn't agree more with the sentiments you express. And on my part also, can I offer sincere congratulations to all the fantastic female award winners. And also to delegates on the line, thank you for attending this important event to mark International Women's Day through our celebration of women innovators. As Emily said, I'm the director at Innovate UK, responsible for this programme and a number of our other central programmes. And so I'm going to say a few words about diversity and inclusion in innovation. The first thing I'd like to say is that it's enormously important. It really matters hugely. And if you take no other message away from my remarks today, please do take that one. This topic matters. And all of us at Innovate UK are committed to that. And there are two reasons, really, I think, why it matters. The first reason is that it's the right thing to do. And the second reason is that it's good for innovation. It's good for companies and it's good for society. So I'm going to say a few words about each of those two points. Although not much about the first. And then I'll say something about what we're doing, how we're doing in the UK on innovation, and then the approach we're taking to Innovate UK, including the strategy, as Emily has indicated. And I'll make a point too about male allies before closing. So to the first point about inclusivity being the right thing to do, I'm not actually going to say that much about it, but I think the point is worth making. The reason I'm not going to say much about it is that I think it's self-evident. I don't need to say it and you don't need to hear it. It just is the case that we should not discriminate against anyone on any grounds at all, and nor should we leave anyone behind or exclude anybody. To do that would damage them as individuals, and perpetrators, it would damage perpetrators too. So we should not do it. I don't have anything else to say on that topic. It seems to me self-evident. So let's move on to the question about inclusion being good for innovation. So obviously I represent Innovate UK, which is the UK's innovation agency. And we define business innovation as the commercially successful use of ideas, the application of ideas. So the process that creates new products or services or processes. And we help companies to develop new products and processes and services and to get them to market faster. The kind of new products and processes and services that our women innovators are creating and that Amanda spoke to earlier. And this matters for all of us in society, since it's companies that make things that we need in our lives available at scale. So millions of people and hundreds of millions of people can benefit from them. And I would just invite you to take 30 seconds now to look around you, wherever you're zooming in from, and see how many of the things that you can see within eyeshot that have not been designed by somebody and made available to you by a company. Pretty much everything is, from your desk, your laptop, your coffee cup, the bricks, that tiles and glass that made your house, your notebook, the breakfast you just ate, the light switches. Pretty much everything has been that you can see is the result of innovation in the past. So what you have today is the result of yesterday's innovation. And you can afford them because they're made at scale, and that is delivered to us by companies. So helping companies to do that for the next sets of products are incredibly important. And the COVID crisis has brought the idea about availability at scale into stark relief, not just for the UK, but also for the wider world. We need globally access to COVID-19 tests, to COVID treatments, to vaccines, to PPE, and a host of other medical devices and therapies at scale. We don't need 10 or 1,000 of something, or even a million of something. We need billions of these things. And because companies make things available at scale, that is one of the reasons that innovation is so important. And of course, that's true not just for COVID, but for all products in everyday life. And we're really proud in Innovate UK to have helped UK businesses address the COVID crisis, with a couple of high profile examples being our support for the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine And the first lateral flow test to be approved by the MHRA in the UK was funded by Innovate UK. So that's why business innovation is really important. So within that, why does diversity matter? Well, the first reason that it's really important for business innovation is that when you're trying to do something really tough, you need all the help you can get. So we really need everybody who can make a contribution to make that contribution. So that, if you like, is a kind of quantity reason why we need diversity. But there's a quality reason as well, and that is that that help is better when it's diverse. And so companies are more successful when they have diverse boards, when they have diverse employees, and when their products and services are designed to be more inclusive. So innovation is more successful when it's diverse. And it's not just me saying this, there's a huge amount of evidence that proves it. And on the subject of COVID, one high profile example, which I just love, is that it won't be lost on anyone that the core technology in Pfizer's messenger RNA vaccine was developed by a German company called BioNTech, which was a firm founded by Uğur Şahin and Özlem Türeci. Sorry if I pronounce his names incorrectly. They're Turkish immigrants, or one's a Turkish immigrant, the other's a child of a Turkish immigrant, to Germany. And a man and a woman. And so you couldn't get a better example of the power of diversity, and we're all benefiting from that. But there's more statistical evidence. So that's a case study, if you like, but let me give you some examples. So McKinsey, the consulting firm, have been tracking diversity in companies since 2014. And in May of last year, they published their latest report. It's called Diversity Wins. It's easily downloadable, worth downloading and reading if you haven't already done so. And they conclude that companies with the greatest gender diversity on the exec teams are 25% more likely to outperform competitors on profitability than those in the bottom quartile. So that's profitability 25% higher. And if you, that's for gender diversity. And if you include ethnic diversity, or if you consider ethnic diversity, that figure, improvement figure, increases by 30%. So putting it bluntly, more diversity means more profit. Emily referred to the Rose Review earlier, and they looked at gender and entrepreneurship. And they point out that if women in the UK started businesses at the same rate that men do, there would be 1.1 million new businesses, and that would add £250 billion to the UK economy. The group We Are Purple, who study disability and represent disability interests, report that the UK businesses lost about £17 billion in 2019 because the products and services they're offering were not usable by disabled people. And Boston Consulting Group have reached the same conclusion. So there's lots of information that tells you that you need to have diversity in your workforce and in your boards and in your products and services, and that to do so actually brings reward. It's not just a moral thing, although it is a moral thing, but there's also a good business reason to do it. So innovation matters, diversity and inclusion is an important part of successful innovation. So how are we doing in the UK? I'll pull together a few stats here, although both Amanda and Emily have sort of given some information too, so hopefully it's not too repetitive. To be frank, the picture's a bit mixed. So on the plus side, the Hampton-Alexander review that Amanda spoke to has shown that the number of female directors is increased. It's increased in the FTSE 100 by 50% over 5 years. And that women now hold a third of all the boardroom roles in Britain's 350 top companies. That's terrific. There's a couple of lovely examples from the Build Back Better report published by the government last week alongside the budget. And these are astonishing numbers. So 49% of the UK's fastest growing businesses have at least one foreign born co-founder. 49%, that's just astonishing. And if you look at the unicorns, so that's with more than $1 billion of value, we've got 14 in the UK, and 9 of them have at least one foreign-born co-founder, which is well more than half. And that is just amazing, as it speaks to the power of getting the right talent into the UK, and also the power that different people and different perspectives bring when it comes to building businesses that are successful. And as Emily has said, you know, our own applications from women applicants to us has grown by 70% over 5 years. So although it's far too low, that is a step in the right direction. So there are some signs that are positive, but there is a downside too. So the Boston Consulting Group report that women founders or co-founders receive lower levels of equity investment per company, if you like. So men established companies get better funded in the early stages. The British Business Bank indicates, this is a shocking statistic, so this is from 2017, that for every £1 invested in a company by the venture capital community, women-led companies receive one penny. I mean, that is just really, really disappointing news. It's not the BBB's fault, but it does seem to be the case. So something needs to be done about that. And in the R&D community itself, the International Innovation Barometer from 2020 shows that 83% of innovation teams within firms have a majority of male workers in them. So not only are the company founders getting less money, but the R&D process itself is very heavily dominated by male perspectives. And as we've just seen, inclusion means better results, right? So it means that the output of those R&D groups is likely to be less good than it could be. And the issues extend beyond women. So Kitching report that disabled entrepreneurs find it more difficult to access startup capital. And you know, that is good. At Innovate UK, although we're 70% up, we still receive four times more bids from male-led applicants than we do from female-led bids. And that just can't be right, frankly. So we do have a problem. And while it's getting better, it isn't getting better nearly quickly enough. And it means that our businesses and our economy overall do less well than they could. So it is important, and we're doing only partially well here. So let's talk a little bit about what Innovate UK are doing. And Emily's sort of explained a little bit about, you know, we've been on this journey for 5 years or so, and we've made some good progress. And in the last year of that period, if you like, and over the last 12 months, we've been working on an update to our corporate strategy. So I'm responsible for that. And this is a high level strategy that guides everything that we at Innovate UK do. And the drafting and the finalizing of that narrative is still work in progress. So I can't say too much about what will be in it when we publish, but I can say one thing, which is that we will be making EDI a priority within the strategy. So not just as a footnote or something embedded but invisible within what we propose to do over the next 5 years, but as a key priority on how we will work as we go forward. And that, I think, is a big step. We've never had that at the strategic levels as declared intent before, not in the strategy documents that we've published. So that's a big step forward, I think, and recognises the importance of the topic. So there'll be more news in due course, but we'll firmly set our hearts on continuing to work to try and include representative diversity in all our programs going forward. So specifically in the current period, we're going to work to get better data on our applicants and on our winners, and targeting outreach programs to specific underrepresented groups. And at the moment, the data that we've got is due to, a couple of different ways of doing it. But, you know, more recently, we've been doing surveys and asking people to report. And that's partially been successful, but some people don't fill the form in, or they fill it in a way that's less useful. So, you know, we're kind of guessing a little bit as to what the data is in respect of the not male, female, but the more, you know, finely granular distinctions that you might need to make in order to target something useful at the right people. We'll continue to support our female and young entrepreneurs through the Women in Innovation program and through our Young Innovators program. And we'll work with our EDI role models to get the messages out to inspire more people to step up. And so that's a really important responsibility on the winners of today's competition that Amanda has just announced. You know, we are going to help you with your business ideas, and hopefully you'll create really thriving and prosperous and successful businesses on the back of your hard work with a little bit of help from us. But we do ask that you explain to other people in the community and to people who might want to follow in your footsteps how you've done that and that it is possible, so that they also feel the self-confidence to step up and have a go themselves. And of course, we'll continue to work closely with our partners in the Knowledge Transfer Network, the Catapults, and the investment community. And we've had great support from those bodies. Just to spare Alicia's blushes, but we've had really, and Siobhan, we've had great support from KTN and Poonam. So thank you to them. And I'm really excited about continuing to work with them as we implement the strategy over the coming years. And the objective is to bring the level of participation up to a point where it's truly representative of the UK population as a whole across multiple characteristics. And as we've said, there's a long way to go. But we have made an excellent start, and building on that excellent start, I'm delighted now to announce that we will be running another round of Women in Innovation competition for women entrepreneurs this summer. So normally it's a biannual event. We're going to not have the gap year this year. We're going to run another competition this summer. So more news about that in terms of opening dates and so and so soon. But if you've got an innovation idea, if you're a woman on this call and you think you might like to apply, you can start thinking about preparing your arguments and thinking about what your business case might look like, so that you're in a position to make an application in due course. And I'd like to thank Emily and her team at Innovate UK and the KTN Catapults for their support and hard work over the coming years. So I'm thanking them in advance because I know how hard they will work to deliver it. And I just wanted to say thanks now before we get stuck into it with our sleeves rolled up. So just a final topic, really, before I bow out here. And that's on the subject of male allies. So it is our view that male allies are an important element in achieving success, particularly in respect of female participation in innovation, but across the board too. And I am somewhat conscious that I speak as a white man in his 50s, you know, somebody who perhaps had advantages in early life that were denied to many. So educators as parents, I went to an excellent school, the local comprehensive, I might add, but it was an excellent school. And I had the benefit of an Oxbridge education. So in a way, as I kind of entered into my kind of life and career and attempts to make a living and all that good stuff, I had quite a sailing wind behind me, quite a following wind behind me. Not everybody has that. But is there a risk then, as we make this push for greater inclusion, that we men, who let's be frank, are not the focus of these efforts because we don't think it's broken, that we might feel disenfranchised, right? Or that we might somehow feel unwelcome, or as if our ships have sailed, we're somehow sort of no longer fashionable. And I wanted to make the point, really, that unreservedly, absolutely not, right? So inclusion programs are about being inclusion. And that does mean being inclusive to the likes of people like me. So any other 50-year-old men on the call, do continue to step up and do what you're doing, right? It just means not exclusively so. So I wanted to make that point. It is quite an important one. And also for we, the incumbents in the system, if you like, we have a sort of duty and an important role to play in the signals that we send. So we need to embrace the inclusion of people who are different from ourselves, and we need to be seen to do this. And we should welcome newcomers into the communities and events and activities and programs that are run. And it matters because even if we succeed through programs such as this to getting underrepresented groups to step forward, if when they do so, they feel unwelcome, they probably won't come back. Or they might not give of their best. And I don't think we have to make a song and dance about it. We just need to be quietly open and welcoming and non-defensive. And to encourage those who are entering an arena that might be new to them and that therefore might feel a bit uncomfortable to them, to just kind of be welcoming, really. And that means we need to improve the system. So many underrepresented groups report that the system is a kind of obstacle to them. You know, it's how we take it for granted that things get done. But for people who sort of feel themselves outside of the system, it can feel a little bit alien to them. So we need to make it more navigable and more welcoming and easier to use. So I would say, if I'm allowed to ask for help, To all the existing incumbents in the UK innovation landscape, please do try and make the effort to welcome newcomers of whatever colour or race or creed or gender or characteristic. We need all the help we can get, and more diversity means more success. And actually in the UK, one of the things that is fantastic is it is such a rich variety of people who live here. And that's one of the great triumphs of our nation, I think. And we broadly rub along pretty well. I mean, definitely not perfectly, but compared to many parts of the world, you know, we are pretty inclusive and pretty welcoming. So let's make sure that people step up and they feel welcome, and that we all benefit from the talents and energy that they have. So I just want to finish by quoting the Reverend Jesse Jackson. And the comment he made is, inclusion is not a matter of political correctness. It is the key to growth. So I couldn't agree more with that sentiment. So I'll leave you with that thought. Thank you for listening, and thank you for helping advance this important agenda item. And do have a great conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your words, Paul, and really for stressing and making it clear the commitment that Innovate UK has to promoting equality, diversity and inclusion. And I know they're your words, but I know that those words would be shared and the sentiment would be shared by all of the senior leaders in Innovate UK. Our executive team, but also, you know, our council as well, and others across UK as well.
They certainly would. You are absolutely right. That's not an assumption. That is absolutely true.
Yeah. And the point you made about male allies are really, really important. This is about all of us working together on this agenda, and also, you know, reflecting on the system-wide challenges as well, which is so, so important. So thank you, Paul. You also mentioned actually the importance of working together in partnership with KTN on all of this. And absolutely, we could not deliver the Women in Innovation programme without working with KTN. They play such an important role in delivering the support with the programme. So I'm now delighted to be able to hand over to Alicia Greathead, who is the Chief Executive Officer of KTN. Now, before joining KTN, Alicia was Global Director Research Engagement at Heriot Watt University. She's also led delivery of Newton Fund, which is a $735 million global research and innovation fund on behalf of Bayes. And she's also worked in Delhi and China and with the UK, RCUK offices there. She joined KTN, and one of the things that she's worked hard on since joining is the new strategy for KTN. And diversity is central to that strategy, and I'm sure she will now kind of explain to you why that is and the work that KTN are doing and their plans for the future on all of this. So Alicia, thank you for being here, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Emily, for that introduction. And also, it was so nice, Paul, to just hear that honesty. You know, having male allies in my own career and life has been so important, so it's really great to have that voice today. So firstly, it's a massive pleasure to be with you all today. We've had a really brilliant turnout, and I think it's going to be a fantastic day. And when I was on my run this morning, I was thinking about last year, because last year at this time we had a similar event where we met face to face in London. And it was a really great experience for me. I'd just been in my job for a few months. It's quite new to the job. And being in this room with so many female innovators, it was just really inspiring and really enjoyable. And I came away from that event so energized about the opportunities ahead. It was brilliant. And I'm sure some of you on this call today will have been there as well. And since then, since last March, we've all faced COVID-19, we've faced a global pandemic together, and the impact of this pandemic has changed all our lives across the globe. It's affected every single one of us, and also in really, really different ways. And with the impact of, well, the massive impact of COVID-19, we've also seen the real inequalities that exist. And those inequalities have been brought right to the forefront over the last year. I'm a mum of two. Emily talks about her children going back to school today. I'm in Scotland, so I've still got one at home homeschooling. But I'm a mum of two, and as I said, I was a relatively new CEO when the pandemic hit. So I've really felt the impacts of the last year. It's been really hard. But it's shown me, and I hope or think all of us in this meeting, in such a profound way, how creative we can be, how adaptive and agile. And probably most important for me personally was really the importance and the real power of collaboration and partnership. And we know big challenges like COVID, which is a really great example of a big challenge, that they present real opportunities for change. They force us to think differently. They force us to come up with new ideas and really, really challenge our way of doing things. And this type of massive disruption, it can motivate us to collaborate. It motivates us to innovate and create the real positive change that we all absolutely need to see in the world. And COVID isn't the only big challenge that we face. As we all know, we've got other enormous challenges, and the prime example would be climate change. And we know that climate change will be impacting all of us in years to come. It's already impacting on many of us now in both our personal lives and our businesses. But to make those changes that we need going forward, we need to be coming up with the solutions to those really important challenges. We need to be bringing together really diverse minds, diverse ways of thinking. And we know that women play a really critical role. And by connecting people with different backgrounds, different perspectives and experiences, we can make research and innovation better and create a much more diverse and inclusive system. And Emily, well, actually everyone, Paul, Emily and Amanda, have really clearly articulated, using numbers and hard information, showing that diversity isn't just a nice to have. It has a real economic and societal impact. And we absolutely need to be accessing the best talent, nurturing those great ideas and innovations to benefit both the UK, but also our wider society. So Emily talked about our role working with Innovate, and our job at Innovate UK, our purpose is to create diverse connections to drive positive change. We want to create, working with all our partners, a more inclusive innovation system and a more diverse network of innovators. And you, all of you on this call, I'm sure, I wish I could speak to you over the coffee break, but all of you will know that the innovation journey can be a really positive one, and it is a really positive one, but it's also hard. And going from an idea to market, it's not easy. It requires a whole range of know-how, of investment, research, like connections to other people. And at KTN, we connect you, we connect innovators to new partners and new opportunities to drive forward innovation with the aim of turning your ideas into something that can change the real world, products or services that really make a difference. And we've got a team of 200 experts based around the UK. They cover all different sectors, ranging from creative industries, manufacturing and health. But we also have an enormous network, and you're part of that. It's actually around 250,000 innovators. These are people like you doing innovation, mainly in business, but also in universities and in government. And when we look at that network, we know that women are underrepresented in parts of our network and in many sectors in the innovation system. And I attended an event, it wasn't an Innovate UK or a KTN event, I attended an event recently where there were 86 attendees and only 5 of those were women, and all 10 speakers were white men. So we still face these types of situations, and they feel really uncomfortable. And Paul was talking about that feeling of welcoming people. We all need to play a really key role in welcoming and including people into our innovation activities. And working with others, we've been setting up activities in many of these areas to give women and give you opportunities to get together and share experiences. And there's lots of examples I could give in quantum, manufacturing, transport. But we know we have lots more work to do, and we're working with Innovate UK and other partners to try and change that. And as Emily said, last year we launched the KTN strategy, and we are really committed to support a more inclusive KTN, our own organisation, and we're working really hard to create a more inclusive system more widely. And since last March, we've held 27 events as part of Women in Innovation, and that included welcoming over 4,500, some of them are here, new members to our Women in Innovation community, which is brilliant. And now, in this situation where we are, we're all dialing in on Zoom and all remotely, most of the world is now working remotely, and that gives us a brilliant opportunity to connect in ways that we might have not considered previously. It gives us opportunities to be so much more flexible, which is brilliant. But we know there's much more work left to do. But today we are here to celebrate all we've achieved so far in creating a much more inclusive future together. And you are the role models. You, everyone here on this call, you're the role models for girls and women around you and boys. And all of you here are working in innovation, you're generating new ideas. And this gives you the power to create a better world for all of us and to make positive change. And I was so pleased that we've just announced the Women in Innovation Awards, and even more pleased that the focus is on making the world a better place, and a massive congratulations to all our winners. But all of you taking part in this event today, everyone here is creating our future. You're creating our future economy, our future society and environment. And this is the time when we really, really need to be thinking about that and challenging that. And I very much hope that we at KTN, that we can help you on that journey, and wish you all the very best. So I just want to finish by saying some thank yous, first of all, to Siobhan, our own colleague from KTN, but also, of course, to Emily and our brilliant colleagues at Innovate UK, and also to UKRI, the UK Business Angels Association, Founder Vine and Extend Ventures, and all our other partners. But mostly to you all for joining in today, and I really hope you gain a lot from all the events and meeting all the speakers. So thank you so much, and I hope to meet you face-to-face very soon.
Thank you, Alicia. So we've come to the end of our opening address now, but what an opening address that was. Thank you to Emily Knott, Paul Mason, Alicia Greeted, and of course, Amanda Soloway, Minister for Science, Research and Innovation at FAES. If you want to find out more about our 40 incredible Women in Innovation Award winners, you can find out more about them directly after this session or in the attendee hub. I've just posted a link over to our program page, and there's a lot more information over there that you can share and read about our incredible award winners. And also thank you to Paul for the exciting announcement about the next Women in Innovation competition opening in summer 2021. So please make sure you're signed up to our newsletter to be the first to find out about when it will officially open and the briefing event for the awards. At that point in time of the briefing event, we'll be outlining all of the support that you can get for help with the Innovate UK competition as well. So once again, I just want to say a massive congratulations to all of our award winners. We'll be back here at 11 a.m. where we've got four more great sessions lined up for you. You can join us on the main stage where we'll be joined by a host of expert speakers to discuss inclusive innovation. UKBAA are hosting a live showcase session with a panel of investors and some of our new Women in Innovation Award winners to give you top tips and feedback on what makes a great pitch over on stage two. You can join Innovate UK Edge and Inventure over on stage three to change the narrative around international opportunities in technology and AI, or pop on over to stage four with the Heroics Institute are hosting a Women in Innovation Live Sprint Challenge. We'll see you after the break. In the meantime, keep the conversation going on Twitter with Women Innovate and network with our incredible delegates. Thank you all so much for attending our opening address, and we'll speak to you after the break. Thank you.